Good evening. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Amy Burkett. This is the first of our two-part discussion on cyber safety. Tonight, we focus on children. Next week, we'll explore how the internet has made identity theft an even bigger concern. When it comes to our children, parents try to do everything they can to protect them, but the World Wide Web offers new threats many parents may not fully understand. National research shows 79% of teens admit they aren't careful enough when giving out personal information online. 64% of teens say they do things on the net that they wouldn't tell their parents. Almost 1 in 8 kids, ages 8 to 18, discovered they were communicating online with an adult pretending to be much younger. Well, one of the most frightening aspects of cyber bullies and predators is that they often strike right in your own home, sometimes while parents are in the very same room. Law enforcement officials say parents can and should have say in what their kids see and do online. Tempo Indepth's Laura McHugh shares expert tips every parent should hear before letting their kids loose on the World Wide Web.
When you send your kids to play outside, you probably lay out certain ground rules.
Be careful. Don't go out into the street. Watch out for strangers.
But what do you tell them about the dangers right inside your own home?
There are people out there hunting for children. You hate to say it. They're out there on a daily basis in these chat rooms, trying to talk these kids out of their houses and away from their safety to commit only God knows what type of crime.
In Montgomery County, Hatfield Township Police Detective Patrick Hanrahan has always talked to his kids about the risks lurking online. According to statistics, he and his wife Jen are among the 80% of parents who worry about their kids getting exposed to predators on the internet.
Look at the news. There's so many bad people out there. There's people, all the sexual predators, and you know they'll do any means that they can to get to your children. So you want to protect them as best you can.
The Hanrahan 16-year-old Brittany loves texting on her cell phone and updating her Facebook page.
I normally go on a few times a week, only about once every 2 days or so, but not every day and only for a short amount of time. Normally check comments and maybe if there's new pictures up, I'll look at that.
I'm in another league that's on ESPN. This one's on Yahoo.
Brittany's 14-year-old brother Patrick also enjoys text messaging, but online sticks mostly to sports websites and fantasy baseball.
I have friends that I see all the time on their Facebooks, on their MySpaces, on anything if they're playing games and texting and phone calls. I have some friends that are on definitely too much.
Neither Brittany nor Patrick has ever had a serious problem with predators or cyberbullies. Their parents vigilantly limit the time they spend online, keeping them involved in school and sports instead.
I ask questions, I talk to them, and I want to know what's going on.
Detective Hanrahan keeps their computers in common areas like the kitchen and family room.
When they're on the computer, they're on it in open areas. They're not taking it and hiding it in a corner or locking in a room. They're in accessible places where we're walking in and out, looking over the shoulder, and just making sure, you know, we know what they're on.
Both parents know all of the teenagers' passwords. In addition, Jen regularly checks the cell phone bill, looking for unusual phone numbers or times of day.
I do print out the bill. I look at it each month. I do check to see when she's texting, when she's making phone calls, and have monitored that. There have been times that she has been texting at 1 or 2 in the morning, and I bring it to her attention.
Experts say it all comes down to communication and having an open dialogue with your children. That way you can recognize when something seems wrong.
Sit down with them while they're online. Let them show you around so that you're aware of the sites that they go to, the capabilities that they have once they get online, and that way then you're aware of what's going on and where they're at.
Criminal Prevention Officer Tom DeFrank of the Bethlehem Police Department recommends parents help their kids choose a neutral screen name, nothing that's too suggestive or reveals too much personal information. He says kids should never provide their name, phone number, address, or the name of their school, never agree to meet face-to-face with someone they met online, and never send a photograph of themselves to someone they don't know.
Once something gets out online, once it gets out onto the internet, you just can't erase it and make it disappear. It goes to so many different places that anybody can see it. Practically anybody can see it. It's the World Wide Web is the World Wide Web.
DeFrank says parents should also learn the lingo. You might be able to decipher some of these obvious abbreviations, but what about these? These 7 acronyms all indicate that a parent's watching. LMIRL stands for Let's Meet in Real Life. ASL, for age, sex, location, GNOC, get naked on camera. These are some of the tamer acronyms we found with a simple Google search.
So by learning some of these, it helps you figure out what's going on online. And if by chance the children are getting into something that might be dangerous, objectionable, you can be there to help intervene and prevent anything serious from happening.
According to Officer DeFrank, some parents may want to install controls offered by your internet service provider or by special software to track your kids' online conversations and block certain websites.
Once you install that, it's almost like recording what activity has occurred online. You can see the different websites that they've gone to. You can see the emails and the instant messages that have been exchanged. And it can also keep record of the keystrokes that they enter, so that you're aware of what activity they've had.
At the Hanrahan's home, Patrick and Jen never had to go that far. They try to respect their kids' privacy and teach them the consequences for breaking the rules.
If they see that we are texting too much, then I could lose my phone, I could lose the computer, and only be able to use it if it had to do with school. So I could definitely lose things if my grades are down as well.
Nowadays, you don't know what to expect. You don't know who's on the other end of the keyboard, so you have to be. You have to be very proactive and know what they're doing and who they're communicating with.
As a police detective, Hanrahan knows too well what can happen if you leave your kid's safety to chance. For Tempo In-Depth, I'm Laura McHugh reporting.
These days, computers are a part of everyday life. I remember I didn't take a typing class until I was in high school, but my 8-year-old son started playing on a computer when he was just 3, and these days he's a pretty good darn typist. Well, the latest statistics from iSafe show 42% of kids surveyed admitted to being bullied while online. 1 in 4 had it happen more than once. Even worse, 35% of kids have been threatened online, and 1 in 5 have had it happen more than once. As parents, we see the dangers of the net, but our kids rarely do. Tempo In-Depth's Crystal Fisher has more.
Good morning, Mr. K.
Good morning, Ms. Bernarda. Good morning, Baxton.
Good morning, Mr. K.
In this secure classroom, students and teachers greet each other by name. Face to face, they know who they're talking to. But in this BlackBerry, iPhone, Bluetooth, and My Ear tech-savvy era, interaction after school hours mainly takes place on the less secure internet.
Sometimes you don't know who it is. Sometimes you maybe do know who it is. You're not picked on at school. It's like over, like your cell phone texting, someone calling you, over the computer, different things like that.
Under the cloak of the World Wide Web, kids and predators are free to do and say as they please. When conversations turn to threats and insults, experts call it cyberbullying.
Cyberbullying is when you misuse your chat rooms or computers and you use it to hurt other people.
You could get really upset, depressed, and it could affect you for not a day, not a month, not a year, maybe course of a couple years, and maybe your life.
Chances are you know a child that's in this situation. Latest statistics from eSafety educators at iSafe show 42% of kids have been cyberbullied. 1 in 4 have had it happen more than once. There are no bruises or black eyes to mark the abuse, so 58% of kids haven't told their parents or school teachers. Experts say the issue's only becoming more prevalent, so communication's key.
Here at Saucon Valley Middle School, they've created a safe place for students to discuss their issues. They call it Student Teacher Advisory. It meets about every 6 days, and they talk about things that range from PSSA scores all the way to cyberbullying.
We want to give each student an adult advocate in the building, somebody, an adult that they can go to and talk to them about a problem that they would be having.
Assistant Principal Tom Halisak says most situations start at home but don't stop there.
When it happens outside of school, normally it finds its way in because it affects the kids at school. And when it affects the kids when they walk through our doors, then I'm there to, you know, step in and try to mediate between the kids.
And though the medium for bullying has changed since you were a kid, the reasons haven't.
Maybe if they're a little bit overweight, if they're like really skinny or something, the way they act, the way they dress.
You're not wearing the right kind of clothes, or, you know, your jeans were dirty. But the biggest thing I think that really hurts kids is when they start talking about sex.
When sexual talk turns to texting, it's now referred to as sexting. Principal Pamela Bernardo fears many students don't think of the damage making private things public might have on their future.
when you put something on electronically, that's out there forever.
So sending a picture, say, to your boyfriend or girlfriend that seems okay at the time, maybe later when you wish you hadn't done that, or you broke up with that boyfriend or girlfriend, now they have some personal information, personal stuff about you that you may wish they didn't have.
Vince Jones works for NOVA, the Network of Victim Assistance in Bucks County. He travels to different schools teaching students about the dangers of the internet.
Like the metaphor of the swimming pool. I mean, we can put up fences and try to keep, you know, kids out so they're not accidentally drowning, but maybe the best safety is to teach them how to swim safely.
From stroke to stroke, NOVA offers instructional programs to students of all ages. Here in the elementary school, a NOVA rep asked how many students play on the computer. No surprise, they all did. So how do we teach our kids to surf safely?
In the elementary program, one of the things we'd like to do is bridge offline safety to online safety. For example, we always teach our children offline never to talk to strangers. So we make the connection, well, what is a friend? And the word friend online is a little different from friend offline.
As technology advances and children grow, so do safety concerns.
Technology is always changing, and now that parents are on Facebook, that will make it uncool now for high school kids, so they'll move on to something else.
So experts say keep an eye on everything.
And the kind of children that would be at risk in real life probably are the same people that would be at risk online. So those young people searching for that first kind of intimate relationship, or those who are depressed, or those who aren't fitting into their peer groups.
The idea of bullying has taken on an important focus, whether it's face-to-face or cyber in nature. And I think we need to embed it in a great deal of what we do.
And when cyberbullying's talked about, kids at least know what to do. Seventh grader Katie Young at Saucon Valley shares some wisdom.
Well, if you've been cyberbullied, you should just tell your parents, tell the cops, anybody that you can trust. If you're cyberbullying somebody else, stop. Because what if, like, you were being cyberbullied? How bad would that hurt your feelings?
Feelings that may be spared if parents, teachers, and students are all on the same page. For Tempo Indepth, I'm Crystal Fisher reporting.
Thanks so much, Crystal. We'll continue our conversation on cyber safety right now with a couple special guests joining me in the studio. We have Detective Christopher McCarty and Assistant Chief Ronald Manescu from the Allentown Police Department. Gentlemen, thank you for your time. We appreciate it so much.
You're welcome.
Let's start and talk a little bit about child pornography on the web. Chief Manescu, it's just scary out there.
Well, there's a lot of sites that people have access to where they exchange information amongst each other to share photographs of small children. And obviously it's illegal if they're sharing that information. And we try to monitor those sites as best as we can. We work in cooperation with the Lehigh County District Attorney and the Pennsylvania State Police. And we have members of a task force, a regional task force that we work with to try to monitor that and deal with those issues as quickly as we can. But it's quite a daunting task. There's a lot of people out there that are utilizing the web for child pornography. And when we come up with folks that are engaged in that, we do prosecute, and with the assistance of the district attorney, we try to prosecute it to the fullest extent that we can.
About how prevalent would you say it is that you're able to narrow it down to a certain person and really start charges on someone?
Without getting into details, the technology that's out there sometimes is geared toward helping law enforcement. I don't want to get into details, but there are some interesting ways that we can monitor and track some of the activity that takes place. And unfortunately, I have to leave it at that.
But then you use that. I guess my question really is, how frequently are you able to press charges? Once a month, once every 2 months?
It depends, because we have, we have a lot of, we don't have a whole lot of resources dedicated toward it. But when we do, and working with the task force, it happens a little bit more frequently. So the officer that might be assigned to the task force that's from Allentown, he may be involved in some cases that are actually outside the city. So the frequency is, we're doing a pretty good job. We now have two officers assigned to the task force, and they're coming up every couple weeks, they're coming up with a person that is being involved with child pornography.
So hopefully we're cracking down, but it seems almost like growing weeds outside. You pull one and three others pop up.
Well, and you have such a large net that's out there. I mean, it truly is the World Wide Web. I mean, it's not only happening in this section of the country, it's happening all over the world. So when we see the exchange, we're concentrating on the local aspect of it, but it could be coming from a different country, it could be coming from a different state. So it's quite a challenge from an investigative standpoint in narrowing these folks down and bringing them to a successful prosecution.
Detective McCarty, talk to us a little bit about how you monitor gang activity on the internet.
Often gangs will utilize social networking sites to get in touch with other juveniles, start the cultivating process of recruiting them, and we'll monitor to see what kind of communications are going on.
What do you see? Are they preying on the more quiet or shy or the people who don't have real networks to be a part in publicly, and they see these people and they'll reach out to them that way?
We used to only have to worry about, with our children, who their friends are and what neighborhoods they're hanging out in. Now you have to worry about who they're communicating even on the internet with. And if your child is, if there's some dysfunction at home and there's not a lot of communication or not feeling loved, they may reach out to these groups that are in part of the recruiting process, tell them they're gonna be a family, they're gonna show them love and help take care of them. And little do they know what they're really getting involved in.
What advice would you have for a parent, though, to help prevent their child from being even more susceptible to gang activity over the internet?
Number one, it always starts with communication. Know what your children's doing, what they're doing. Know who their friends are. Know what they're up to in the internet. Keep those lines of communication open. The more you talk to them, the more you know, the lower the risk level.
Great. Let's go to the issue of sexting now, which seems to be such an epidemic among our teenagers. Laws could be changing, and this could become a prosecutable offense as child pornography. And these young people are doing it to themselves. People aren't taking advantage of them, they're taking advantage of themselves.
Sure.
How do we educate these teenagers to stop this?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, some of the kids are doing it because it's a moment of fun. They're looking at it as a moment in time that's fun, but that moment of time is captured forever once it's out there on the internet. And you do have people that will try to take advantage of it or are drawn to those type of pictures. So, a female taking a risque picture of herself and sending it to her friends is going to end up in a lot more places than she thought it was. And that might draw a predator toward her. He might like the way she looks or what she was doing at that particular moment in time, and may try to reach out to her in other ways, and that causes some problems, obviously, for the parents and for the teenager. So they need to understand that moment of what they're considering fun at that particular time can have some downstream consequences, literally for the rest of their lives. I mean, something like that, those sexting pictures that get out there, can be quite damaging, and kids being kids will take advantage of it and distribute it and make comments about it, put it on blogs or Facebook or MySpace, and the kids that are sensitive, a little bit more sensitive than most, can have an adverse reaction to that. I mean, nationally there's been stories of kids committing suicide because of mistakes that they later found that they made in putting some things out there that they thought were fun but turn out to be pretty traumatic.
I know we don't have a crystal ball, but do you think that it will take being able to make criminal charges against these people to wake up even the teenage population and realize this isn't just fun? This is so much more severe and damaging than that.
Right, and that's going to be the challenge as to whether or not we legislate that kind of behavior, because I know in Pennsylvania we're geared toward more rehabilitation of young offenders than we are of trying to strike home a
But it's
a
happening
heavy,
so frequently.
Message.
How can we rehabilitate the vast numbers that we hear about in the high schools of kids doing this? It's amazing. I mean, when I'm very old, but when I was in high school, if you held hands, it was a big deal.
Right. I think going back to what Chris said, the communication between the parents. I mean, I don't think we can legislate parenting. It's going to come down to communication to the parents. Them being involved with their children and them making sure that they understand the consequences of that moment in time and what the downstream effect will have on them.
Gentlemen, thank you for sharing your information. We appreciate it so very much. Detective Christopher McCarty and Assistant Chief Ronald Minescu from the Allentown Police Department, thank you again.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
When it comes to internet usage, what you don't know can hurt you. You and your children and your grandchildren. Preschoolers, kindergartners, and kids in early primary grades may fall prey to internet criminals and predators. That's why it's so important for parents, grandparents, and guardians to know about the internet and the threat to youngsters as they travel through cyberspace. Tempo Indepth's Grover Silcox tells us more.
We have some parents who just think that whatever's out there is safe because, oh, why would someone put something out on the internet that wouldn't be safe for our kids?
But people do set traps for children on the internet. Children as young as 6 get barraged with pop-up ads asking them for personal information.
Because they come to school needing to know name, address, phone number, but then when they see someone ask them on a computer, what's your name, address, and phone number, they think it's okay.
Who should you go to for help? Ask your parents.
First grade teacher Sue Young and library media specialist Jane Brennan coach youngsters on recognizing and responding to potential internet dangers.
Things pop up and it'll say, like, congratulations, you won a prize. And what they're doing and what I'm saying to them and their parents are saying to them is, don't click on that, that's not true. You know, exit out or tell your parents right away.
But to parents, grandparents, or caregivers, especially those middle-aged and up, know what poses a danger to kids using the internet.
I probably know a little bit more than my parents, who know more than my grandparents.
Come on!
Diane Pingarelli, mother of 7-year-old Kyle and 10-year-old Tricia, says she probably knows more of the internet's red flags than her own parents do.
How's school, Tricia?
If you said to them, what is a pop-up, I don't know. My father maybe, but I'm not sure about, for sure about my mom. I think they would know what a chat room is, and I think that would be more because they've heard it.
Sexual predators may groom a child to trust them, hoping to glean personal information. They may pose as other children or friends. Teens fall prey to this manipulation, but so do younger siblings who want to emulate their older brothers and sisters. What's more, the older children might naively place themselves and their younger siblings in harm's way by posting certain materials online.
Older siblings have Facebook accounts, MySpace accounts, and they think, oh, well, it's okay to post maybe a little brother or sister's picture on there, and even know that they're giving right information for themselves. They're exposing a younger sibling, and they might not even be aware of that.
Technology brings great opportunities, but also great risks.
Fisher-Price makes a digital camera that connects to your computer. I mean, it's one cord, Fisher-Price, and they're even making one cord video cameras that Fisher-Price makes them. I mean, and the kids just know that, ooh, USB, it's three letters. And they even have the drawing on the cord and the drawing on the computer to where it goes.
When it comes to computer savvy, the kids often challenge their caregivers to keep up.
USB, that has something to do with connections, right?
I don't know. I know, but I...
You'll know it when I tell you. It's the connection.
Oh, yeah, the flat cables, I call them.
Kids might go off-road on the information highway, but caregivers can keep tabs on their itinerary by checking the youngster's history.
History? Well, history was a bad subject of mine when I was in school.
Today's parents may very well want to bone up on a new kind of history, browser history. It lists every site a computer user has visited. Diane finds it helpful in monitoring her daughter Trisha's internet activity.
You know, I go in and check her history a couple times a week and make sure that she isn't anywhere that she's not supposed to be.
Trisha, like a growing number of people, enjoys Skyping. Skyping is a free internet service that allows users to speak with and see another user anywhere in the world.
What really has to be done with Skyping is you have to watch who it is that is trying to contact you.
On this day, Trisha Skypes her cousin.
Why do you like to Skype?
Because it's sort of like a chat room.
Trisha's Skyping's limited to a safe list of friends and relatives. There's a growing number of folks in the neighborhood who Skype in much the same way.
We do, but we only have one contact person on our list, so we can only Skype one individual.
Baby boomers often adapt clumsily to the evolving cyber culture, but the latest generations are growing up within it, and that's making them quite savvy in navigating the internet. Even still, kids need supervision as they wend their way to maturity. That's why educators like those at Harry S. Truman Elementary teach them to safely surf the net. They also work hard to find them kid-friendly and safe websites.
At this point with Daniel, I'm not terribly concerned. The computer is in a common area and we're very familiar with the websites that he visits. A lot of them are recommended by the school.
We try here to teach the kids the safe places to go, to find those images, find those pictures, so then they know when they go home if there is someone that might be not so tech savvy or computer savvy, that they can say, well, my teacher told me to go this way or to go through this.
Education still serves as the key to separating the perils from the vast opportunities that await children and their parents in cyberspace. For Tempo Indepth, I'm Grover Silcox reporting.
We've just scratched the surface of cyber safety for kids. If you have a young loved one on the net, we urge you to do some more homework on your own. Here are a few options to get you started. Pennsylvania Attorney General Tom Corbett has launched a fantastic program called Operation Safe Surf. You can head to attorneygeneral.gov for more information. The site is filled with useful ways to watch out for your kids' safety. At cyberbullying.us, you'll find a comprehensive study about what parents need to know about the issue. Click on resources for lots of statistics and helpful tools, like a cell phone agreement for parents and kids. Finally, it's time for all of us parents to learn a new foreign language. At netlingo.com, you'll learn how to speak their language. Did you know KPC means keeping parents clueless? I don't know about you, but I don't want to be clueless anymore. If we arm ourselves with the right information, we won't be. Please join us next week as our cyber safety conversation continues with a look at what adults can do to protect themselves from identity theft. Thanks so much for joining us. Good night.
Support for Tempo In-Depth is provided by the members of PBS 39 and by...
Thank you for watching tonight's Tempo In-Depth. PBS 39 is your local public television station, showcasing and informing you of events in our area and information that is important to you. But PBS 39 needs your help. The state has proposed eliminating funding for this station. This could greatly impact Tempo. Please show your support for PBS 39 and the local shows we bring to you. Go to WLVT.org and click on Become an Advocate. Fill out your name and enter your zip code. From there, you can contact your local legislators and choose what letter you would like for them to receive. Supporting PBS 39, your local public television station, is important as ever.